to let go. Till the day I fully realized that God could deliver me and more. Raise me up to higher heights and give me joy I'd never had before. And I thank Him for the miracle that brought me from the rock to the right. The miracle that saved me, that brought me from the darkness to the light. And I thank Him for the never-ending song of joy I sing. Of my soul, I felt a longing just to trust in His embrace. And I said, Lord, can I love You? Can I hope to ever look upon Your face? And I took Him at His word. I said, believe in me and You'll never fall.
Hello, everybody. This is Pastor Tim Rome. I want to tell you some good news. I'm really excited about this. We are going to have a live service. We can get together physically, and that will be next Saturday, October the 3rd at 5 o'clock. It's Saturday, October the 3rd at 5 o'clock. It's at 505 State Street. That's where we normally meet on Wednesday. So those of you that have been joining us on our Wednesday services in the past, you would know that's where that's at. But if you come, it's 505 State Street, and when you get there, you go around the back where the parking lot is, and there'll be a door there, and that's where you come in. We'll have someone there, greeter, to greet you there. I'm excited about this. Saturday, October the 3rd, we'll be ministering live right there. We really worked on this building. Where the teen ministry used to be in this building, we gutted it out. We painted the walls, we put lighting in, we put speakers up, we stripped the floor and polished the floor, we put a little platform up, we put a back thing in the windows so it covers the windows, and we can get quite a few people in there. But then, because of the social distancing, we want to make sure there's enough room, so we went over to the room that we normally used as the auditorium on Wednesday nights, and we put up a large screen TV, about a 72-inch TV, and it'll be connected to a camera. So that's we're calling that our overflow room. So if you come, we'll social distance, we'll have sanitizer, we ask you to wear a mask. We're going to have the room that we just redid, and also we're going to have the auditorium that we used to use. We have that all set up for an overflow room, and it's going to be a great and a wonderful time. That's Saturday, October the 3rd. It's going to be a wonderful time. We're going to have a great time. So now when you come, remember, come. It's 505 State Street. If you've not been here before, you come to 505 State Street, and then you go around to the back, and that's the door you enter in. And God bless you. I just want to talk to you for 1 minute about the Apostle Paul. Some think he was possibly the greatest apostle there ever was in the Bible, and I really like the Apostle Paul. And he had ministered in Thessalonica at the church there, and there had been such a problem there, or a ruckus that happened in the city. They didn't like Paul, and so he had to get out of the city, and the city officials said, we don't want him back in here. And so he could not go back to the church of Thessalonica and minister. And it kind of troubled him and bothered him. And so it was the city officials saying he couldn't meet. But listen to what he wrote in 1 Thessalonians chapter 2 and 18. He said, wherefore we would have come unto you, even I, Paul, once and again, but Satan hindered us. The city officials were the ones that were stopping him, but he knew behind the city officials was Satan. But the Apostle Paul was smart. He said, I can't minister to you personally. I can't come. But he found a way to minister. He sent Timothy, his spiritual son, and Timothy would go to the church to give them information from Paul and then come back to Paul and give him information. So Paul was clever. He said, Satan's hindered me from getting there, but I'm going to find a way to minister to you. And so this is our way of finding a way to minister to you. We're going to have a great time. We've been doing it like this, and we'll continue to do this. But we also want to make available and encourage you to come this October the 3rd at 505 State Street. It's a Saturday, and it's at 5 o'clock. And we are going to have a fantastic and a wonderful time. The first week, we're trying to figure out the children's on how they can come. If you have children, let them sit with you during that service. And in the future, we're going to do something. But we're trying to get our feet on the ground. We're trying to figure out how to do things. So please work with us. We love you. We want you to be here. And I know it sometimes can be a little tough. That's what I did when I was a child. I sat in the service, and I remember being bored at times and getting a little fidgety at times. One time I took my shoe off and scratching my foot. My mom said, put your shoe back on. That's going to happen this first Sunday, possibly. But don't worry. From that time on, we're going to figure this thing out. Come join us. We're going to have a great time at 505 State Street, October the 3rd, on a Saturday at 5 o'clock. We have found a way to minister to you, and we're not going to be hindered by Satan. God bless you.
Good morning, and we are so excited, as we just heard Pastor's announcement, that we will be meeting soon. We cannot wait for that. But I'm also just excited for those of you who are going to continue to meet at home. We will be online as well. So it's just exciting times, and we are moving forward for the Lord. So praise God for that. I just want to remind you of some other things that are still going on here. And the first thing is that the kids, as Pastor mentioned, will be in the main service with us, but we are going to have something special for them during that time. And then also we are continuing to meet on Zoom. So they are still going to be having their classes that are just the perfect Bible lesson that God has for them. So continue to have your kids join up with the Zoom classes. That's for all ages. And then youth group, our teenagers are meeting on Wednesdays here at the State Street location at 7 p.m. Gathering and Dunamis will have their next meeting October 9th. And then be sure to check your mailboxes, because we are sending out the October bookmarks for our Bible reading plan. So those will be coming to you shortly. Right now, we're going to just transition into a time of offerings and tithes. And last week, we were talking about the story when Jesus used Peter's boat to minister. And then Jesus told Peter, you know, go back out, go fishing again. And he said, Lord, we haven't caught anything, but at your word, I will do it. And we just reminded that following God's word is so important, but that he wants to be able to transfer abundance into our lives. And so kind of coming off of that, remembering God's heart I want to read Matthew 6:33 to you this morning. It says, "But seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things will be added to you." And so that goes right along with following what God says and doing what he has for us, seeking first his kingdom, and then all of our needs are met. Then he brings us peace, all the things that we need. But it comes first with seeking his kingdom. And so as we give this morning, that is one way that we are continuing to put God first and to put his kingdom first. And it's a promise that we can count on. So let's pray. God, we thank you for your word. We thank you that we can trust it. We can partner with you as your kingdom is coming to the earth, and that I ask that you would help us and show us ways to put you first and to seek your kingdom first this week. I thank you for the word that you are about to put into our hearts this morning as well. We thank you for the anointing that you've put on Pastor, and we know that he, we just thank you for his faithfulness to continue to deliver that. And so I pray a blessing on everyone that listens, that the word would go deep into their hearts and produce a harvest. In Jesus' name, amen.
Hello, everybody. I'm so glad to minister the Word of God to you again today. I want you to know that we are going to make it. And when I say we are going to make it, what I mean is you are going to make it, this church is going to make it, America is going to make it. Yeah, you know, sure, we are facing some challenges, the virus, the violence, the economy, relationships are being challenged right now because people are so close together. Some are having emotional challenges, others are having some spiritual challenges, and some just tell me they're just in turmoil itself. But I want you to know, we are going to make it. Again, you are going to make it, the church is going to make it, America, we're going to make it. So that's good. Now, some would say, hearing me say that, they would say, well, maybe he doesn't understand the severity of what's going on. Well, I think I do. You know, I'm not that naive. I understand there's a lot of stuff going on, but I have good news. Even if I don't understand the severity of what you personally are going through, God does. And I want you to know that God is a God that does the miraculous all the time. So you're going to make it. He's going to help you. He's a God of the miraculous. You know, the astronauts said when they went up in space and they looked down and they saw the Earth, they said, that is miraculous. They go, that the Earth is there hanging in space like that. What's holding it? I mean, so you can try to explain it, but it's miraculous and it's God. Get up in the morning, early in the morning, and watch the sun rise. And you see the sunrise every morning, even when it's been a dark night or a troubled night or a troubled day before, you see the sun rise again, and you say to yourself, that is miraculous. Watch a baby either being born or just take a newborn baby and hold the baby. See the little fingers move and look at the mouth and the eyes and feel that baby. Hold it for a while and you'll say, this is miraculous. God does miraculous things all the time. Talk to somebody who went through a challenge in her or his life. Ask them, how did they come out of it? And many will say, we don't know. We prayed about it. We trusted God. It was miraculous what took place. Everything turned around. So we are going to make it. With God, remember, nothing is impossible. Now, God loves us. He really does. He loves you very, very much. He loves all of the human beings on this earth. He wants all of us to come into his family. And that's why he sent Jesus Christ, as a signal to us how much he loves us. The Bible says God loves us so much that he sent Jesus Christ to this earth to die for us if we've sinned or fallen short. And what's nice is all of us have sinned and fallen short. So he sent Jesus so you and I can receive Jesus, have forgiveness of our sin, live with God here on this earth, and then when we leave this earth, be with God throughout all eternity. That's love. God sent Jesus for all of that because he loves us. But he didn't stop there. He sent us a love letter. Yeah, the Bible. The Bible is a love letter from Almighty God. And in that love letter, he puts stories. He puts stories about those that have failed. He puts stories in there about people that have succeeded. He wants to encourage us. He wants to inspire us, but he also wants to instruct us. So he gives us stories about those that made it, and he gives us stories about those that succeed, those that didn't make it. He wants us to see both. You know, any good parent, a good parent will say, you know, son or daughter, I've made some mistakes in my life, and I want you to learn from my mistakes. I don't want you to make the same mistakes that I've made and go through the same things that I've gone through. So any good parent will say, look, there's a wrong way of doing things, and I've done it, and it didn't work out. And then every good parent also wants to say, there's the right way to do things, and I've succeeded in these areas when I've done it right. God is the best parent there ever has been. He's the father of all father. He's the parent of all parents. And so in the Bible, the love letter that he sent us, he tells us stories of those that have made it, and he tells us stories of people that haven't made it, and he wants us to learn from those stories. They're true stories. Today, we're going to take one of those stories, and we're going to look at that story. It's a biblical example of someone who succeeded, somebody who is facing a big situation, a troubling situation, a situation that looked a lot bigger than he looked. And yet, he put his trust in God. He did certain things, and it brought God's blessing into his life. So God put it in his love letter to us so we could read this. We can learn from this. And if we do what this person did, we can get the same results. It's like God saying, hey, this is what works. I want you to read this. I love this story. We've talked about this at Good News Church different times. When we face certain situations, I like to go to these stories and encourage the people coming to the church, and even myself, believe me, myself, because when you read these stories, it encourages you and gives you instructions on what to do so you'll succeed, because God wants us to know. So if you join me in your Bible or on the screen, I believe they're going to have it there. In 2 Chronicles chapter 20, starting with verse 1, it says, "And it came to pass after this also that the children of Moab and the children of Ammon with the others besides the Ammonites came against Jehoshaphat to battle." Jehoshaphat was the king of Judah. And all of a sudden, there's three kingdoms at least coming against him. That's not a good thing. That's like the virus, violence, and the economy. It's like relation, all that's trying to hit. Well, he has a lot coming against him. And it says in verse 2, "Then there came some that told Jehoshaphat." Remember this, this person's going to tell Jehoshaphat bad news. Don't you have people in your life that always likes to tell you the bad news? I mean, you already see the bad things, but they want to tell it to you all the time. They're not always the same people that want to tell you the good news when it happens, but there are certain who just love to tell us bad news. Well, Jehoshaphat had someone like that in his life, and it says, "Then there came some that told Jehoshaphat, saying, there cometh a great multitude against thee." Like Jehoshaphat doesn't know this already. "And beyond from beyond the sea, this side of Syria. And behold, they be in Hazan and in Engedi." This is not good. And it says that Jehoshaphat feared. Now, I want you to realize something. This is very important. His reaction is that he feared. But his response is what we want to follow. See, he feared his reaction. And you and I might fear our first reaction. But then how do you respond? How do you rise up? He needed a miracle. There was three kingdoms coming against his one kingdom. And he had a big problem. He had a big challenge going on. He had a triple threat coming against him. I like to say, when I talk about this, have you ever felt like everyone seems to be against you? Well, Jehoshaphat had everyone coming against him, and everybody was against him. And now, again, his reaction and our reaction when we face things a lot of times is fear. But how do we respond? We want to follow through on how he responded, because how he responded, not his first reaction, but how he responded is how he received God's blessings, God's miraculous power. So we want to follow not his first reaction, we want to follow how he responded, because then we can open ourselves up for God's miraculous blessings. So let's find out. Number one, if you're taking notes today, he decided to take time to seek God. He decided to seek God. It's important that we take time to seek God. You and I need to take time to seek God. When things happen, the first person or the first entity we should go to is not a wall and worship it, or an idol and worship it, or a person and worship them. We need to take time to seek God. And that's exactly what Jehoshaphat did. I want to read to you verse 3 of our text. It says, "And Jehoshaphat feared." Remember, that's his reaction. But now watch his response. "And set himself to seek the Lord." He said, I'm going to seek God. Why? Because he had fear rising up on the inside of him, and where he'd get faith is with God. So he spent time seeking the Lord, and he proclaimed a fast throughout all Judah. He said, look, everybody, we're going to fast. That fast is when you don't eat for a period of time, and you spend that time with God. He said, I'm calling a fast through all Judah. See, when you fast, it's when you're trying to look at things from God's perspective. When you fast, you're trying to look at things through God's eyes, his viewpoint. You're not trying to twist God's arm so he'll bless you. God already wants to bless you. All you're trying to do is get yourself right and quieted so you can hear God's directions. Your body gets weaker, but your spirit gets more sensitive, and you can pick up on things when you fast you normally would not. So the first thing he did, he took time to seek God, and he asked all of Judah to fast with him. That would be like a mayor of a town telling all the citizens, this is very serious, we all need to fast. This would be like the governor of a state saying, this is very serious, we all need to fast. This is like the president of a country, like the United States of America, the president coming out and saying, everybody, we need to fast. This would be like a mother and father or a parent telling their children, we need to fast. We're taking this serious. So the first thing he did is he took time to seek God. That's important. Seek God. The second thing he did is he took time to pray. Not just seek God, but he took time to pray. We saw that Jesus, and we spent 8 weeks talking about prayer, following Jesus, but prayer was important to Jesus. Prayer became important to the disciples that followed Jesus. And prayer should be important to all of us that live today. But we're looking at Jehoshaphat here in the Old Testament, and we're saying prayer was important even to him. Now, when we read through this, I want you to see different things that happen and certain things he says, because I think this is a very powerful, powerful prayer. In verse 5, it says, "And Jehoshaphat stood in the congregation of Judah and Jerusalem in the house of the Lord before the new court." Let me talk to you for a moment. What it's saying here is that he stood in the temple of God. God had delivered them out of Egypt, had brought them into the promised land, and then they built a temple to honor God. And God said when they dedicated that temple, he said to them, when you stand in this temple and pray, I'll hear your prayer and I'll answer your prayer. And so he's there in the temple of God praying. Now, the thing I want to tell you is this: any of us that have received Jesus Christ as our Lord and Savior, God says his spirit is on the inside of us, and we are the temple of Almighty God. He says, I no longer have a temple made with hands. You are the temple of Almighty God. When you gave your heart to Jesus Christ, the Spirit of God came on the inside of you. When you pray, God hears your prayer. But back here, they had to go to a physical temple. Here, you and I are the temple of God. It goes in verse 6 and says, "And said, O Lord, God of our fathers." It starts out, God of our fathers. He doesn't even say our God. He says, remember, you're God of our fathers. He's remembering God. And says, "Art not thou God in heaven?" God knows he's God in heaven. Jehoshaphat isn't asking the question for God. He's reminding himself and all those that are listening, aren't thou the God of heaven? So everybody will remember, he's a God of our fathers that brought us here. He's the God of heaven. We ought to know that. Now watch this. He goes on. He says, "And ruleth not thou over all the kingdoms of the heathen? And in thy hand is not power and might?" He's saying, I remember you. Everybody will remember who God is. And remember, he has power and he has might. We remember who God is and he remembers how powerful God is. What's happening is he's hearing about these people coming at him. He maybe even sees them afar off. We don't know. But what he does now is he starts building his faith by talking about, you're the God of our fathers. You're a God who has power in heaven and on this earth. You have great power. So he's reminding himself, he's building his faith. He's building his faith. And that's a great way for us to pray. Heavenly Father, you're the God that hung the stars in the sky. You're the God that put the moon and the sun where it's at. You're the God that made the lakes and the oceans. You're the God that put all the living things on this earth. That just builds our faith. And that's what Jehoshaphat is doing. But let's go a little further. It says in verse 7, art not thou our God? Now he says, aren't you our God? I like that. That's a good question. Now it was Father's God. Now it's, aren't you our God? He's reminding all those that are standing there with him, he was and he is. Let's go on. Who driveth out the inhabitants of the land before the people of Israel. They saw about when Israel was coming into the promised land, that God's power was driving out the other people that were there. And giveth it to the seed of Abraham, thy friend forever. He's talking about Israel. And they dwelt therein and have built thee a sanctuary. He says, we've come to this country that you gave us. It's your power, wasn't it, that drove out people? And we built you a sanctuary here, the temple of God. It says, for thy name's sake. And now he's going to say something here, but it's really what God had said when they dedicated the temple. Watch this. If when evil cometh upon us, as the sword, judgment, or pestilence, or famine, we stand before this house in thy presence, for thy name is in this house, and cry unto thee in our affliction, then thou wilt hear and help. He's saying about that temple back there. I want you to hear this. God said you are the body. You are the temple of God. And when you call out, he will hear you and he will help you. That's how we can pray. Father, I know that we don't have a physical temple that we built with our hands, but we are your temple. And when we pray, you tell us that you'll hear our prayer and you'll answer our prayer. That'll make your day. In verse 10, it says, and now behold the children of Ammon and Moab and Mount Seir, whom thou wouldest not let Israel invade. When they were coming out of Egypt, they were going by these people that are now coming against them, and God said, don't destroy them, just walk by them. And that's what he's saying right now. Whom thou wouldest not let Israel invade, when they came out of the land of Egypt, but they turned from them and destroyed them not. In other words, we did not destroy them. Behold, I say how they reward us. Look what they're doing. We didn't invade them, and now look what they're doing. They come to cast us out of thy possession, to cast us out of the land that you've given us, which thou hast given us to inherit. Now, there's another question. O our God, wilt thou not judge them? He's building this case amongst in the face of the congregation. His first reaction was fear, and now he's building faith. He's saying the right things to build faith in everybody that is there. It goes on, will you not judge them? For we have no might against this great company. There's thousands and thousands who are coming against him. He says, we don't have any might against this great company. I don't have any power against this virus. I don't know what I'm going to do about a job or the economy. I don't know what I'm going to do about the violence. You're the temple of God. God has blessed you, and God will continue to bless you. He says, we don't have any might against this great army that cometh, and neither know we what to do, but our eyes are on thee. It's time to take the time to pray. Many battles are won in prayer. Many battles are won on your knees long before you get to your feet. And Jehoshaphat knew this, and he was praying because he knew that battles are won in prayer before you ever physically ever face them. My friend, I want to encourage you. Seek God. Take the time to pray. Many of the things that are coming against you will be defeated in the prayer time. Take time to pray. Jehoshaphat prayed, and he prayed a faith-building prayer. Not a fear prayer. he talked about them coming against him. Before he ever talked about that, he said, aren't you the God of our fathers? Aren't you the one that delivered us? Aren't you the one that has all this power? And won't you deliver us? He built faith. And he said, and by the way, these people are coming against us. He asked three questions. He said, are you not the God of heaven? He asked them, did you not deliver us? And then he said, will you not handle this situation? At all the time, he's just building faith and reminding everybody, yeah, God's going to do that. Jehoshaphat reminded himself who God was. He reminded himself how powerful God is. He reminded himself that what God had done in the past. And he reminded himself that God still cares about them, and God had said he's going to answer their prayers. That's a faith-building prayer. Number one, what do you do when you have situations coming from every angle against you? Well, we're learning from the love letter that God wanted us to learn from. Number one, take time to seek God. Number two, take time to pray. And number three, Jehoshaphat admitted he needed help. It's not weakness when you turn to God and say, I need your help. Actually, God says when we humble ourselves, he exalts us. The Bible tells about a story where two people go to the temple to pray. And one talks about how wonderful he is, and the other one humbly says, God, I need your help. And Jesus says when they left the temple, the one who humbled himself had his prayers answered. The proud person did not. So it's okay to humble yourself and say, I need your help. I don't know what to do. In verse 12, it said it this way. O our God, wilt not thou judge them? For we have no might. He admitted, I need your help. This great company that cometh against us, neither know we what to do, but our eyes are upon thee. We have to look to God. America, we don't really know what to do. We have all kinds of smart people, but there's a lot more going on that we think. And we need God's help. Admit we need God's help. Families, church people, other pastors, let's admit we need his help. You know, miracles take place after we let God know we need help. When we admit to ourselves it's impossible without God. What I'm facing right now is impossible without God. And I need his help. Humble ourselves and God will exalt us. So what did we do? Number one, we said, take time to seek God. Number two, take time to pray. And number three, admit that you need God's help. There's something about that. You just relax. Oh, good, I don't have to have all the answers. God has all the answers. And then number four, focus on God and not the problem. He said, our eyes are upon thee. He focused upon God. He could have continued to look at the problem, and several of us do. We pray, and then we still continue to look at the problem. He said, you know what? I've already told you who you were, who you are, and what you've done. I already said how powerful you are. And I told you about the enemy. And I'm choosing to keep my eyes on you because I can't handle this. Turn from the problems and turn to God. Turn from the situation and turn to God. Turn your eyes upon God. Go ahead, focus on God and not the problem. A lot of people, you talk to them and all they talk about is the problem, and you never hear them talk about God. I know it's hard, but we can do it with God's help. Start talking about God and not the problem. See, God is not your problem. God is your helper. You know, there was a lady who was really well known. She had gone through a lot of adversity in her life. She wrote books and spoke in a lot of different Christian functions. Her name was Corrie Ten Boom. And I love something she said, and I love to repeat this because she said this. She said, if you look at the world, you'll be distressed. And if you look at yourself, you'll be depressed. But if you look to God, you'll be at rest. If you look at the world, you'll be distressed. Keep your eyes on God. If you look at yourself and your own power, you'll be depressed. But if you look to God, take a deep breath, you'll be at rest. keep your focus on God. Now, what I like about this, he says, I'm going to keep my focus on you, and I can't handle this. And God doesn't speak from heaven and say, you're a wimp. This is how God responds. Watch how God responded. Remember, this is a love letter to us. He wants us to know how we are to act. Now, watch how God responds to Jehoshaphat, talking about, you're the God of our fathers. You're our God now. You have all this power. These people are coming against us, but we're going to keep our eyes on you. We can't handle it ourselves. Now watch. In verse 15, and he said, hearken, ye all Judah, and ye inhabitants of Jerusalem, and thou King Jehoshaphat, thus saith the Lord unto you, be not afraid, nor dismayed by reason of this great multitude. It's God speaking. For the battle is not yours, but God's. That's God speaking. After Jehoshaphat responded the right way and said, I need your help. I'm keeping my eyes on you. God said, watch me. I'll show you. God wants to bless you. God is good. We want to seek God. We want to spend time in prayer. We want to admit we need his help. And we want to focus on God. And then we want to stand in faith. What stand in faith simply means is, okay, God, you said this, I'm going to believe you. And these attacks may try to come, but I'm going to fight them off and say no. We call it the shield of faith. When the enemy throws things at our minds and our emotions, our faith says, I'm standing for God. I don't care what it looks like. I'm going to continue to believe God. And that's what Jehoshaphat does here. He stands in faith. Let me read to you verse 7 of our text. He says, you shall not need to fight, God's still speaking, in this battle. Set yourselves, stand ye still. In other words, don't run to and fro. Oh, what am I going to do? Stand, believing me, and see the salvation of the Lord with you, O Judah and Jerusalem. Fear not, or be dismayed. Tomorrow go out against them, for the Lord will be with you. Oh, I can face it with God. It's just not me. It's God and I. And God is going to handle this. Stand. He said stand. Did you hear that? God said stand. But what do you stand on? God, what are you talking about? Stand. Watch. Let me read to you. It says in verse 20 of our text, and they rose early in the morning and went forth into the wilderness of Tekoa. And as they went forth, Jehoshaphat stood and said, hear me, O Judah, and ye inhabitants of Jerusalem. He's standing, so watch what he's standing on. Believe in the Lord your God, so shall ye be established. Believe his prophets, so shall you prosper. What's he saying? He's saying, stand on God's character. Stand on God's word. Stand on God's truth, because God is truth. So what is God saying when he says stand? He's saying, stand on my character. Believe me when I tell you something. All you got to do is trust God. Stand. And then the last thing. Thank God in advance. Thank God in advance. This is kind of odd. They haven't won the battle. They're going to battle. He said, stand. They're standing. And then they go out. Now watch this. And when he had consulted with the people, he appointed singers unto the Lord, and that should praise the beauty of holiness, as they went out before the army, and to say, praise the Lord, for his mercy endureth forever. Before the battle begins, we learn that Jehoshaphat says, wait, everybody, we've been standing and believing on God's character. Let's praise him first. And they start praising and praising and praising God. So before the army even starts marching, the praisers go out before them and say, let's give praise to God. You know, praising God and thanking God after something happens is gratitude. Praising and thanking God before something happens is faith. And he's saying, I'm putting my faith, I'm standing in faith, so let's start praising him right now for the victory. They were already praising God for the victory before the first part of the battle even took place. Thank God. Give him praise. Thank God. Give him praise. I said that was the last point, but I simply want to say, this would be the last point. Then they enjoyed the results. You can enjoy the same results as you and I apply the same thing. As we look, it says in verse 22, and when they began to sing, not before that, But when they began to sing and to give praise, not moan, not groan, but when they decided to sing and pray. This is what's interesting. It's almost like God's waiting. And as soon as they start to sing and praise and you put faith in him, that's when he starts to move. It says, and when they began to sing and to praise, the Lord set ambushments against the children of Ammon and Moab and the Mount Seir, which were come against Judah, and they were smitten. It says here, they were smitten. I'm telling you right now, this is a story we need to look at in the atmosphere we're in, we are in now in this country, with what's going on all around us. We're going to make it. We are going to make it. You're going to make it. The church is going to make it. America is going to make it if we keep our eyes on God. We're going to get through this. We are going to, with God's help, have our victory. We will. We need to seek him. We need to spend time in prayer. We need to admit that we need God's help. We need to focus and keep our focus on Almighty God and not the problem. We need to stand in faith on his character, on his word, on his truth. We need to thank God in advance. And then we need to enjoy the victory. My prayer is that you realize and understand what we've talked about today is simply this. You are the temple of the Holy Ghost. He had to stand in a physical temple. You and I, we are the temple. He said when that temple was dedicated, that God said, I'll hear your prayer. God said, when you're a believer, you can use the name of Jesus Christ to pray. And when you do, he hears your prayer. Why don't we just pray right now? Father, I pray for those that are listening, those that are watching. And I ask, Father God, that they are blessed. We pray to the God who made the universe, the God that hung the stars in the sky, the God that put the moon where it's at, who put the sun where it's at, to put the earth where it's at, to the God that made the rivers, the mountains, the valleys, the ponds, the animals, the God that put every living creature that creepeth upon this earth and everything that swims in the sea and everything that flies in the sky, that God we pray to you. And we thank you that you are strong and powerful, and you have been a God to our ancestors, and you are our God right now. You were the God to the founding fathers of America, and you are the God of so many millions of people in America still. We turn our eyes to you. We still believe you have that power. You will deliver us. You brought us to this country. You brought us from different countries and different places to America. You brought us here, Heavenly Father. And now there's something coming up and trying to cause trouble in America. And we say to you, won't you defeat them? Won't you whip them? Won't you get them out of there? And you say to us, do you trust me? Yes. We don't know what to do. We don't have the strength. We don't have the knowledge. So we're asking you, Father God, we humble ourselves to you and we ask you, please bring peace into the hearts of your people and bring peace to America. And Father, we stand on your character and on your word. And we praise you ahead of time. We thank you, Father God. We thank you, Heavenly Father. We praise you that you're a God of your word. We praise you and thank you, Father God. We thank you, Father God. We praise you, Father God. We praise you, Father God. We thank you, Heavenly Father. Father, we're going to enjoy the victory. God bless you. And those of you who are joining us, I want to remind you again that Saturday, that's this coming Saturday, October the 3rd, we'll be meeting at 5 o'clock on a Saturday. And it's at 505 State Street in Des Plaines. The 505, if you put them on your Google Maps, it'll take you to the front of the church. But if you go around to the back, that's where the parking lot's at, and there's an entrance there. There'll be somebody there. We want to encourage you to come. We'll enjoy ourselves. We'll continue to broadcast these, but we'd love to see you personally, eyeball to eyeball, mask to mask. God bless you. Look forward to seeing you.